In my opinion, the woman of the hour. This is a person that I met also a long time ago. I remember meeting her mom at church, and she heard me sing, and she said, "Do you want to perform at one of our events one day?" And I never ended up performing at that event. But I think Rhea and I have gone on to do a lot of more excellent things. I appeared on her show. Together we have performed. We've created videos. Rhea Jade is an excellent, excellent youth in our community. She is a singer. She is a songwriter. She's doing modeling. She's doing acting. She is a fashionista. She is so many things wrapped up into one, which is why the name of her show and the person she is, it all kind of fits together. Please welcome, from eveRIAthing, Rhea.
Every day, they can change the world one dream at a time. We want people to be seen, to be heard, and most of all, be appreciated, because I want people to believe that nothing is unreachable if you set your heart to it.
Hello, 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 everybody. Welcome to this week's episode of eveRIAthing, and this episode is actually very, very special because we have prepared for you an episode like no other. The truth is that this year, eveRIAthing will be having its first year anniversary on September 22nd, and it's absolutely amazing to think that just a year ago, this entire journey started. I want to thank all of you guys out there for coming with me on this journey, especially those of you sitting at home. This would not be possible without your support. And of course, all the amazing people that we've guested, because you guys helped keep this show as alive as it is. So over time, I have been watching the clips of eveRIAthing, and there are so many amazing memories that I made, and we can only show so many of them. So today and next week, as part of our one-year anniversary special, we are going to be showing you guys never-before-seen footage, all specifically just for you. So be sure to keep watching this week and next week for our special. Let's go take a step back in time.
How did you know that this is what you wanted to do? Like, was there someone who inspired you?
It's a good question. When I was a kid, you know, really, really young, I have memories of going to see magicians at some of my friends' birthday parties. And I always thought that it was really, really, really cool. And I had a magic kit when I was a kid, you know, I was about 5 or 6, got a magic kit for Christmas and played with it for a little while and never really did much more with it. It kind of went under the bed and magically disappeared. And then when I was 11 years old, I went to Victoria with my family and we went to Tony's Trick and Joke Shop. And I was really excited because I have two younger brothers. And I wanted to get some pranks. That was my plan. It's a trick and joke shop, so I go in looking for like whoopee cushions and the squirting nickels and all that fun stuff. And then to my right, I see this big wall of magic and this guy standing behind the counter. And so it kind of intrigued me. I wasn't really sure what to do. So he went over and started showing me some magic stuff and I was enthralled since then.
And I think that takes a lot of courage because sometimes it's scary to face your destiny and to step up and become all that you were born to be. I think that's scary. I know I sometimes struggle with having the courage just to not allow fear to define me. You know, we all have different fears, we all have different insecurities, and are we gonna be willing to get past that and to make an impact, or are we gonna allow those things to hold us back and to be less than what we could be?
Oh, okay, so let's see. Next one we're going to do is ballad. Let's contact inner Bruno Mars, inner Adele, half and half. Let's see
what we got. Let's see. I'll start with a bit of ballad. Sometimes I wonder if there'll be someone out there standing by me. Make my dreams their own.
Costumes for jazz and that sort of thing. You want something that when you're on stage really, really stands out. So like I brought one of my old costumes and it's just all like sequins. Just something that stands out on stage, that really pops, something with some sass maybe. Yeah. And then with jazz, people usually wear jazz shoes and they come in beige or black. It just makes it easier for turning and stuff. And for something like lyrical, you want something pretty and flowy or like that. So I just have like one of my old costumes is a dress. It's kind of hard to tell, but you get the gist of it, you know. Just something pretty. And then when you're wearing a dress, sometimes we'll wear foot undies or toe pads or whatever, so that we can turn, but it looks like we're not wearing anything on our feet, so it looks like bare feet. And then, I brought these used in like character or musical theater, that sort of thing. And then for ballet, you have your soft shoes, these, and then the point shoes that are so pretty, but they hurt a lot.
Hurts to be pretty.
Yeah. It hurts, yeah. Pain is beauty. Is that what that's saying?
Yeah, pain is
something like that.
Your voice is so simple. Like I just have my band sneakers.
That's all you need. Yeah.
But stretchy pants.
That's it.
That's all you need.
No, we're just like, I'm kind of just laid back. I have like percussion when I just have it in
your ring.
Oh yeah.
It's like those little like tiny thingies. That those. What is that kind of style of dance? Like belly dancing? Is that what that is?
It's like cultural.
Yeah, with the little clinky things. I think it's belly dancing. Oh, Spanish, that's what it is. It's Spanish, yeah. And I have the long skirts.
Yeah. That. And the fans.
Yeah, fans.
We sat together like nothing ever happened here. Oh, with a white house on the hill, black clouds of weather, and the church spire over the river. She still sits there warm in the evening glow. But you don't care about these scenes I treasure, about these west winds. I know. Seems everything around here stays like stone. Seems it's about time, darling, about time we let this all go. Start again anew, cause everything just goes that way, my friend, and every king knows it to be true.
know you also write stories, and I am like a sucker for writing stories. What do you think would be your favorite like plot or like genre type of
book? Genre. I have a very specific one. Drama, fantasy, romantic.
Me too. Me too. You're so much like me. I'm gonna stop.
I mean, I'm not like Twilight, you know, the Hunger Games, yeah. The Host, yeah. All those.
I like the intensity, and then like I always like when there's like a big plot twist where it's like you think someone, but then it's like, no, I was a pickle, I'm a peanut. I'm really into peanut butter and pickles today. I don't know. Maybe I was a pickle in my past life. I have no idea.
I think I was a dog.
I think so. Maybe I was a mosquito. I have no idea. I might actually be, what animal eats a lot of bacon?
Dogs.
I might have been a dog because I love bacon. When I was younger, I used to draw like little like, this is gonna sound really gross, but little like poop things. Like, have you ever seen like little cartoon poops?
Yes, I used to do that with muffins. Yeah,
I would draw little poop things with like flies running. Oh dear, I don't know, I was a weird kid. Oh my. But yeah, those are really good. Ooh, what's that?
Oh, this is,
I like that one.
It was a Christmas assignment for,
it's nice.
I used to go to an integrated art school, so it's really fun. And then, ooh, I have one that I have been working on. It's really,
I like that.
It's really fun.
That's cool.
Make sure to add the color in the eyes so that it looks, because I know that when I look in a mirror and I see, because I have brown eyes, when I see my eyes, they always have that little bit of green, so I tried to add that.
I like it. It's really detailed. Like, the way you colored the eyes, really nice.
And in the next photo, that's an albino version of the girl here. So it's actually about a story I'm working on.
Oh, it's very cool.
Then I like to draw fashions.
Yeah. I love drawing, like, clothes and stuff. Like, it's, like, the most fun thing ever. You just draw, like, random outfits and, like, random hairstyles, right? Because you just, like, mess around. You're like, wee!
Oh, I have something so random. I planned this for Halloween.
Peacock, nice.
It's a peacock girl.
I actually like that. Katy Perry.
Katy Perry, yeah. I want her to have a that would be awesome. I think I could design for Katy Perry.
You That'd could. Be awesome. But like, you know, she works the candy. She could work with peacock feathers. I could see it. That would be a really awesome goal.
And I know you do so many things for a bunch of other people. And do you have a favorite charity, would you say?
That's really hard to pick. I have a lot of favorite charities, just people who are doing amazing things in the world. Sanoa is one of them. This bracelet was made by survivors of sex trafficking in Cambodia.
It's very pretty.
Yeah, I love it. They work with Swarovski crystals and other really high quality materials because they want the women, again, to associate themselves with things of high value because they are valuable.
Exactly.
So they're one of the ones I love. I love Ratnak as well. It just, joy, seeing joy in people who have been through so much, it's inspiring. It makes me stronger every day to see the strength that they walk with. As I mentioned, I work with the Joy Smith Foundation here in Canada because they support survivors. The Dalit Freedom Network, I worked with them for a number of years, and I actually was on staff with them for a year as well too.
Nice.
And they fight racial discrimination in India, so I stand by them. And you know, my makeup is from Radiant Cosmetics. They 20% of all of their profits go directly to women's shelters around the world. So whether you're putting on lipstick or whether you're putting on jewelry or you're wanting to change laws in Canada or change laws in India, there is a way for you to be involved. And that's the thing that I love about it. We just choose to live lives of justice. It's not that hard to do. We find little ways and we're all doing it. It makes a big impact.
Personally, I used to have a love-hate thing with the bacon cheeseburgers, but
oh, I love bacon.
It's kind of complicated, didn't work out. You know?
We're having burgers at our wedding because it is my favorite food.
Why
I
not?
Love burgers.
Why not? Who needs classy shrimp things when you can have burgers?
So
that is my dream.
All of your food groups in it right there.
Right? You got the bun, you got the lettuce, you got the dairy.
Your meat, your veggies, everything. It's all right there.
It's perfect. And it's in the grip of your hands. And you can take it anywhere. You can even dance while you're eating your burger. It's perfect.
I love it. I love it.
Anyways, setting burgers aside, unless of course you would like
I'm going
to
start doing that next time. People are going to be like, where did you get this from? I'm dancing and eating at the same time.
You're like, oh, whatever. Just like going to a party and everyone's like
fist
pumping.
Just watch this episode and you'll understand.
Yeah. You just, here, I'll give you a link.
Yeah, and I know that you also danced at the world premiere of Hansel and Gretel, right? That is so, so cool. I'm so jealous. So tell us, what was that like for you? Like, what was the experience like?
Oh my gosh, I've said these words over and over again, but I have to bring them up again. Amazing experience. It was very awesome. I'm so glad that they chose me to do some roles in the show, and I loved every moment of it. And all the rehearsals were fun. The people were great to work with, and I'm just really glad that I got to do that, and it was just so amazing.
That's so awesome, and that's such an honor as well, right? Like, if I was asked to do something like that, I'd just be like, oh my gosh, is this real? Somebody pinch me, somebody throw water in my face. That would be for like a good week.
Yes.
A good month.
Yes, around there.
A good decade.
Until the rehearsals start.
Basically.
I became really interested in cameras because I'd always seen myself on camera, and we did a ton of home videos and that kind of thing. And I loved seeing myself on the screen, but I didn't really, as a kid, connect this camera is what makes me appear on screen. So at about age 10, I became really interested in that, and I took our family's camcorder and just played around with it and made a whole bunch of home videos. And then whenever we're on vacation, I would, you know, film and that kind of thing. And I wanted them to be professional. So I would make up names. I'd have like produced by Carlisle, whatever. Like, I just make up names because I didn't want everything to be Scarlett Brins, because I wanted it to look professional. And if I'm, you know, acting and I'm editing and I'm directing and I'm producing and I'm in charge of catering and I'm transportation. So my dad was always transportation. My mom was the production coordinator. I starred, of course, and produced and directed.
Your Beyonce moment.
And edited, and then my dog was security, and yeah. But then I wanted like a company name, and Bruins Family Productions was just what my 13-year-old brain came up with, and I thought it was cool.
It's catchy.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I know. I totally know what you mean. Like, when I was younger, I would always record stuff on my family's video camera, and my dad got so mad at this one point because there was this really important recital I had, and I taped all over the entire thing, and it was like a 20-minute video of me walking around the house, giving a house tour, and like eating chips. And then my mom was like, "Oh, we didn't even clean up the house," and I was like, "Mwah." And then at one point, I was just like, "It's a 15-minute clip of me sitting on this couch," and I'm just like, "My hair looks so awesome." That's really just the whole thing for like 15 minutes fixing my hair.
I saw that one. That's cool.
Yeah, it's really cool. So. And you have a nice face.
Oh, why, thank you.
You're a gem. If you could change anything about the modeling industry, what do you think it would be and why?
a lot. I think it's... I don't really want to pinpoint something that I would change specifically, but I do think that they should sort of broaden horizons in terms of height and in terms of weight. I just think that the models that they have now are like, it's such a small percentage of people that look like that and that are that thin, that it just, I don't think it helps to sell the clothing. Honestly, I think if they saw real people in the clothing, it would help sell it better. And there's a few designers who've, you know, they've done some really cool stuff. They, one designer, I can't remember who it was right now, but at that Fashion Week in Paris, he only used plus size models. And then another year, the same designer didn't use models at all. He just used like a rotating clothing rack, which I thought was really cool because the models, for the most part, kind of just look like clothing racks because they're so skinny, right? So I think there's just, there's a lot of stigma around the modeling industry, and even with like eating disorders, and I think a lot of people make it out worse than it really is, but there's certainly things that I would change as well. So.
I agree. I think there should be more models of different heights and sizes. I know there's this one country that I don't remember which one it is, but their mannequins in store are like different body types and different body sizes, so that like if there's one that's similar to you, you can see how it looks on yourself. And I think it really promotes healthy and positive body image because like not everyone looks like that.
Actually, I have a mannequin at my house that I got from a film set. And my sister and I, just out of curiosity, decided to measure it, and it's actually 6 inches too big to model. And that's a mannequin. Like, it's insane how thin they expect models to be.
Yeah.
And even just maintaining that, I mean, I get if you have, like for me, I've had to lose weight and gain weight for movie roles, but models are expected to be this size all the time. So I think it's a little bit crazy to maintain that lifestyle.
Yeah, that's true.
A lot of people always, you know, ask this, right? It's very, you know, oh, I don't have time. Well, you know, in the morning, if I don't have time, I'll just do a few quick exercises. You have some weights, I believe.
I do have some weights. I have super, super tiny weights, so these 5 pounders are good.
Look at that. There we go.
All right.
Okay. Five pounders for you. 2 pounders for me.
All right.
All right.
Here we go.
All right, so all you viewers out there, you stay tuned for our exercise DVD. Jin teaches you how to work out. Rhea teaches you how to eat pizza.
In five easy steps.
Step one.
One low cost of $29.95.
Step two.
Buy it.
Step three.
Buy it again for your
Step
friends.
Step four.
And do it.
Step five.
Order more pizza.
Yeah!
Was
that amazing or what? And I think that the most amazing thing is that I had such energetic guests, and all of you guys out there have the biggest capacity to shine. You are all stars and candles, and that of course includes you amazing people sitting in the audience. Thank you so much for supporting eveRIAthing. Whether it be you sitting on your couch watching the TV or even sitting behind your computer screen, thanks so much for watching the show, as well as liking us on Facebook, tweeting with us, and of course catching up with your favorite guests. And last but not least, I want to say a very huge thank you to our producers, Rayfort Media Group and eveRIAthing Network, as long as our media partner, Shaw Multicultural Channel. Thank you guys so much for watching. Be sure to come back next week for the rest of our first year anniversary special. Until then, see you next time here on eveRIAthing.